Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining. This is Andy White. I will be your host today as we have a short session on configuring IP phones. This is session number one, where we hope to just go through the introduction to configuring the IP phones, just mainly the basics, how to configure the IP phones on the QX. Covering basics of all of our supported phone vendors on how to configure the phones using the IP line settings, how to configure the keys, the templates. We're also going to look at maybe the basics of the SIP phone registration and the SIP messages as the phones try to register. So I thank you everyone once again for joining. And we're going to get started here. I just got to have a few slides to start with. All right. This is the first of a series of summer tech series, as I call it. Configuring the IP phone session one, session two. We've got a couple sessions on the call routing table. Configuring SIP trunks, call scenarios, and auto tenant configurations. If you have any other suggestions, any other topics that you'd like to see covered, be sure to let me know. I'll provide my contact information here at the end of the discussion. And at the end, hopefully, we'll have some time for some questions as well. All right, well, we're going to do the as far as the agenda this morning. We got a few slides showing the configuration options. We'll look at some supporting documentation on the support portal, and then we'll look at the QX on how to configure the IP phone. We're going to look at the IP line settings, the options for plug and play versus auto configuration versus the manual method. We'll look at the MPK options for configuring the keys, look at the templates in the SIP registrations, and at the end, we'll save time for some questions. All right, and looking at our options. Okay, bear with me, I'm just getting over the tail end of a cold here, so I have a little bit of a cough. So hopefully we'll keep that to a minimum. All right, looking at the first scenario. So you've got a QX system. You go to your customer's office, get ready to install it. So the question is, how does it get configured to the network physically? There's several options available. Okay, keep in mind that these systems have at least the premise-based systems have a LAN port as well as a WAN port. Okay, so they can stand alone on a public IP. And on the LAN side, they can also have its own subnet. All right, so here's one of the options. The customer already has a broadband connection with a firewall in place, a DHCP server in place. They've got their PCs already connected. And they're connected to a switch connected to the DHCP server. Okay, one of the options that you can use is just connect the QX WAN, WAN port to that same switch, and the QX will get an IP address from that DHCP server. And the phones have the option of being able to configure through the system WAN port. All right. A second option on a same scenario would be to use a VLAN, okay, where the QX, the WAN port's basically going to have two IP addresses, one on the WAN interface, and secondly, you'll create a VLAN, and you'll give it a second IP address that the QX will have within the VLAN. Okay. The nice thing couple nice options with this VLAN configuration is the fact that the system cannot it can provide or it can be the DHCP server across the VLAN, so it can hand out the IPs to those phones. All right, so it's and it's also going to be it's a good way of separating the voice traffic from the data traffic. All right, and the phones they're going to be in that VLAN. They'll be in a separate subnet. All right, just for that. All right, so that's a good option. A lot of people really like using that when they have the opportunity. All right, the next option would be to configure the phones across the LAN port of the QX. In this case, the WAN port is connected to the similar scenario. The customer's got a broadband connection firewall, has a switch. You connect the QX, the WAN port to that switch. And then the across the LAN port, the phones are on their same. There'll be a separate switch. That's probably the only downside. But the phones will be separate. They'll be on their own network. The system, the QX, will act as the DHCP server on that LAN. And the QX is good because it can get outside access through the internet for accessing the SIP trunks and things like email, so that's a good configuration as well. All right, the other option would be to configure remote phones. So the phones are in this case the local phones are on the QX LAN port, and the remote phones to another office. They're physically located elsewhere. They come across the internet, and through the WAN port broadband connection, they'll configure through that WAN port. All right, there are several options of configuring the phones local on the QX. One would be the plug and play option, and I'm going to show you. We're going to go into all this when we in detail, but first will be the plug and play, where they'll automatically configure as soon as you connect them to the system. Auto configuration is similar to plug and play, but you're actually selecting the specific IP line and extension that the phone's going to be using. And then you have to manually enter the MAC address, so that's the only difference, and choose the phone model. And then the third option would be a manual method, where it's not one of our supported phones, for example, like a door station or a cell phone or a video camera, where you have to manually configure that device. All right, we work with a lot of devices. I like to say any SIP type device, SIP, a device that has a SIP client on it, should work just fine with the system. Okay, including door stations and cameras and video phones and all that. Those are going to work just fine. And then there's a lot of we work very closely. We got a really good relationship with all of our phone vendors. We've just recently gone through and contacted all of our phone vendors, and they sent us some updated models and things like that. So, periodically we'll go through and get a new set of phones, and we'll add those to the product list. So we've got a good relationship with all the phone vendors. All right, so let's take a look here. We're going to see about where we can get some additional information. Okay, so if you go to our website, go to support portal. You should have a login access. If you don't, be sure to register and get access to it. There's no obligation in doing so. But this is where you're going to find all your information. All right, so within the knowledge base, one of the first places you're going to want to go is the QX line. You look at the PBX products, and then click on the, for example, like the QX 200. And then from there, go to the firmware and then the release notes. Okay, we'll go ahead and download the latest release notes. This is for software version 6.2.40. And by the way, we're going to probably release, come out with a new release here, hopefully by the end of the month. So we'll have a new release posted. All right, I often get asked, okay, that the release notes, when we come out with a new software release, always open up the release notes, see what's new, see what's added. We add new features. Almost with every release, something new will be enhanced. There'll be an enhancement of some features or some new features added, some new phones, some updates on firmware on these phones. One of the questions I often get asked is which phone models do we support? Okay, and this is the best and greatest release or location where you're going to find the updated list of those supported phones. Okay, so this is you got the phone vendor, the phone model. You'll see the recommended firmware version. Okay, why do we put that? So what we do is before we come out with this 6.2.40 release, we go through and we test all of our phones, make sure everything's working, make sure nothing has changed. And we will test it with a phone vendor's firmware release. Okay, periodically we will update the firmware on the phones. It's a big job to do that because the phone vendor changes a lot of features and options and things like that. They make some enhancements. Well, that doesn't always work so well, and different things might break, as we found in the past. So we come out with a recommended firmware version. It's not always going to be their latest and greatest firmware from the phones, but we know at this point in time that this firmware version was working great. It establishes a real good baseline. If you have any problems, that would be one of the first things that you want to check. And you might have to downgrade that phone. Although I do not recommend downgrading it for the Fanville phones, because it might ruin your phone. But all the phone other manufacturers, you should be able to, if needed, you can downgrade it. And like I said, we periodically update the release, the firmware release. And then it specifies whether phone supports plug and play and how the phone supports the plug and play, whether it's through multicast or through a DHCP option 66, option 67, and whether or not that phone will auto configure. Of course, all the phones on this list will auto configure. So there you have your Fanvilles and Grandstreams, HTEC, Mitel, slash Astra, Panasonic, Polycom. The Snom phones, SpectraLink, VTech, Yealink. All right, so there you go. There's your latest release, or list of phones. And again, with the down here where you'll see any changed features, you'll see if there's been any new phones that were added, or firmware that was changed. Okay, for example, like the very first option here was the Yealink firmware phones were updated. Firmware for all the Yealinks was updated at that point in time. You can see we did the same with the Fanville, the prior release. All right. Some other documents. You want to search for IP space phones. All right, there's a couple of documents I'd like to highlight, and let's see. The first one here is configuring Epygi supported IP phones with the QX IP PBXs. Let's go ahead and take a quick look at this one. All right, this document talks about the plug and play and auto configuration. Also looks at the supported phones, how to do a factory reset of the supported IP phones, and then it shows all the different phone models. And then at the bottom, there's a section on using a third-party DHCP server. All right, so. That would be the case when the phones are on the QX WAN, and there's another DHCP server other than the PBX. So it shows you some of the configuration options, settings, methods, I should say. All right, it talks about the plug and play, how the plug and play works. Talks about how to configure it. Again, here's your list of phones. And as we go down further, it talks about how to do the factory reset on the phones. So why is that important? Before you go to configure any of the phones to the system, especially if the phone's not brand new out of the box, you're going to want to do a factory default on that phone, so that it starts with a clean slate. There's no previous settings that have been added in the phone that might prevent it from working, or may cause some weird options or feature interaction. And then down towards the bottom, there's a section on using the third-party DHCP server. There's a couple slides on that, and it talks about the option 66 setting, which basically informs the phone when it gets an IP address from the DHCP server. It will also find out where to find, locate, and request the configuration file from the TFTP server, which would be, in this case, would be the QX, PBX. All right, excuse me, let's go back. Another document is the QX IP PBX features on this Epygi supported IP phone list. All right, a couple of highlights from this document. Okay, there's a section down here around, I don't know, page 12 or so. Okay, this is going to show. Okay, this is going to show the different phone models, and going across the top, it's going to show all the different options, whether or not that phone supports that specific option. For example, like OpenVPN, whether or not that phone, somebody asked me yesterday about a particular Fanville model, in particular the X4, and whether it supports OpenVPN or not. And evidently that's not working yet. All right, the other whether we do, some phones will do firmware version control, whether or not it's a supported receptionist type phone where you can add keys, whether or not it supports paging, intercom, etc. You get the idea. So there's a couple sections on that where it has lists all the different features. And then down towards the next section is specific to all the different phone models. Okay, for example, if I go to maybe a Snowm phone, okay, and this phone will specifies here whether or not the phone how to do certain features. For example, like of course it's pretty obvious how to do the call hold, call resume, pick up a second call. But when it comes to doing the transfers, for example, like a blind transfer or a consultative transfer, becomes a little bit more it's not as clear. So it tells you step by step exactly how to accomplish those different tasks. So this is